grab your seat. We are going to go back into worship again. One of the things that I love about being together in this moment and the format that we have is just allowing time for worship, because it's not just about hanging out and talking together. It's about truly experiencing and having an encounter with God. I believe that we serve a living God. I believe that God today can speak to each and every one of you. Doesn't matter if this is your first time here. Doesn't matter if you've been here for a while. Doesn't matter how long you've been following Jesus, or even if you're following Jesus at this point right now. I believe that today is your day to say yes and to begin this journey. But even in that moment, I believe that God can speak to each and every one of us. Please hear this. It's been a while since I've said this. I know I've said it before, and I should probably say it more often, all right? God doesn't speak to me anymore because I am a pastor than he would speak to you, all right? Please, please hear that. God can speak and will speak to you because he wants relationship. Please, I encourage you, if you have your Bible, open it on up. If you have a Bible app on your phone, open it on up. It's not just about what I am even about to say, even though I believe that God laid this on my heart for us today as a church. I believe that through these scriptures and through this worship time, and when we come together, like, these are moments where God can speak to each and every one of us. And I hope and pray that my voice is not the loudest voice that you hear today. I hope and pray that when you leave this place, you're like, you know what? He might have said some good things, but what they pointed me to, and this was the revelation that I have. Not just some really good information, but in the power of the Holy Spirit, a revelation as God opens up our hearts and our minds of who he is. That's what it means to truly have an encounter with God. And I think even in this moment, I know we've talked about it, and we've been in this format now for about a month, and it's incredible. I want to just remind us and encourage each and every one of you of pre-service prayer and worship. There is so much good that comes from this time here. But there's something about setting apart time, setting aside time that just says, I'm gonna pray, I'm gonna worship, not with people just watching what's going on or even people leading what's happening, but just a moment to meet with, to hear from, to have our ears and our eyes in tune with God. And it's been pretty incredible so far. It's been amazing to just to come together and truly pursue God. Even when we started this, we're in a series called Pursuit, right? Like when we started this whole pre-service prayer, a big part of that is there's all across history, any move of God, any massive revival, any massive move of God, all of them have started with prayer. It's not about, is there the right program? Is there the right service time that we have to hit? Is there the right things involved in service that are there? Literally, what changes an environment, what changes a church, what changes a community, and what has the ability to change the world is prayer. A personal encounter. When we corporately come together, a unified pursuit of God. And a big part of that is because we can talk about it a lot. And I think we do. We talk about it a lot. We're going to continue to talk about it. It's because I love to teach, all right? I love to talk about it. But there's a point where we can only go so far when we're talking about something. As a matter of fact, another example of this, I've coached my kids in basketball forever. I coached basketball before they were born. I love basketball and I love teaching. So putting the two together, like, coaching basketball is just, I love it. It's a blast. It's a passion of mine. And a couple of years ago, I was coaching with a really good friend of mine. And we were talking about kind of the coaching plan. He would have a coach, like a every day, the plan would be set up of what we were going to do. And we just started talking about, like, each other and, like, what can we do better? How can we coach each other? And both of our kids were on the team, and there were definitely times where we'd give each other a look, like, he thinks of me as dad, not coach. You have to talk to him, like, moments, right? And we had a really real moment once, and I'll never forget this. We came to the realization that both of us were actually talking too much. That we were in practice and we wanted so hard for them to understand it that we would stop plays and be like, all right, so when this happens, you have to go here. But the only way that they would actually learn that is if they experienced it. And it was literally, we had this revelation like, you know what? We're going to explain a drill and we're just going to let them figure it out. Like if they ever want to pause and ask questions, and there's times where we don't let it get too far out of hand, but there's a point where for them to understand it, and I believe this is us in life too, we can sit here and talk about scripture, and we can sit here and talk about who Jesus is and how the power of God can be alive in your life, and you can even believe that with everything in you. You can know head knowledge what's happening, but until you step out and experience it, so often nothing changes. There's a moment where in this pursuit that we're talking about, there's got to be a moment where we step out and practice. We step out and allow ourselves to experience, not just know. Again, I love talking about Jesus. I love teaching scripture. I love history. I love context. I love backstories. Like, I love all of that. It's so much fun, and I believe it unlocks so much in scripture. But that's not where it ends if we just talk about it. That's why Paul in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, real early in his letter to the Corinthians, the first of two letters, he says to him, verse 4 and 5, my message and my preaching were not with wise and persuasive words, but with a demonstration of the Spirit's power, so that your faith might not rest in human wisdom, but on God's power. I don't want people to be involved in a church anywhere because the pastor seems to be really smart. I hope that every pastor in America studies really hard, right? I hope that the context that they're giving is correct. I hope that there's wise words that come from pulpits all across this country and all over the world. But the truth of the matter is we won't truly be the church that Jesus Christ had in mind until we experience his power. Until we have an experience with him that changes and shifts and solidifies everything that we've been hearing. Because we can hear it all day long. But there's something different from a moment when you're like, oh my word, it works. Again, basketball example, okay? I don't say a whole lot. I don't talk about basketball all the time, so give me just a couple, all right, today? And this one involves my son, Brody. When Brody was really early playing basketball, I would tell him over and over again, when you get the ball in from out of bounds, the other team can't guard you until you cross half court, okay? He wasn't confident dribbling with his left hand, so he would immediately dribble with his right hand. And I was like, here's the deal. There's nobody there. Dribble with your left hand, okay, up to half court, because what it's going to do is the ball's going to pull you to the left side. Then right before half court, you can cross over, and you have the whole court to work with, right? And the whole time he'd get into games, and he's like, I'm not comfortable. So he dribbled with his right hand, he dribbled to the right side, and then he's stuck, okay? So they were losing pretty good, all right? And I'll always remember this moment, and him and I joke about this frequently. I'm sitting underneath the basket. I wasn't coaching that year. We had just actually moved here to the area, and I was like, there's a lot on my plate. Like, I'll be there, but I wasn't coaching that year. So I'm sitting under the basket, and I literally remember they're losing, and Brody's catching the ball, and I was like, Brody, please just try it. Like, I'm pleading with him, right? And he catches the ball, and literally they're going this way. So he looks at me, right? And he goes, and he starts to dribble with his left hand. Like, literally that moment of like, fine, Dad, I will, okay? He dribbles down with his left hand, crosses over, the Red Sea parts, right? And he dribbles with his right hand right down the middle and scores a basket. Okay? And he's on this side, your dad, somebody in this region over here, right? You just got at, okay? Makes a basket on this side, and literally he lands and goes, like, it worked. And I was like, thank you. Like, okay? Which is really funny when it's basketball and second grade maybe, or when we moved, was it first grade, right? Funny moment. But how many times do we, as followers of Christ, read this book? And we're like, man, we've got all the knowledge and we know what he's saying. But we don't actually do it. And I know that because the number of times that even in ministry, I'll have phone calls or conversations with people and they'll be like, you're never going to believe what God did. And I'm like, I bet I will. Because when we do what he asks us to do, we get the blessing that he promises is in Scripture. But so often our pursuit is for head knowledge and we're like, we just need to know more and I don't know that I'm mature enough in my faith and I don't know that I can do enough and I don't know if I could teach people that are there. Here's the deal. When we step out in faith and just do what he asks us to do and follow what he asks us to do and do all the things we talk about, I promise you, our life looks a lot more like Scripture. It looks a lot more like the overflow that he has for us in Scripture. It's not just about having a really good argument, but it's about having an encounter with the living God. That's what Paul understood, is that it was about a revelation so that the people in Corinth wouldn't believe in who he was or what he said. They would believe in the God of the universe that he talked about. One of the things that I love about Paul is the number of times that he's like, I'm just a normal guy. It's not me. When people are like, oh my word, you're an incredible teacher and miracles are happening. You must be a God. And he's like, no. And would run out of town. Like, I promise it's not me. But understanding that when we have an encounter with God, it's in those moments that things are solidified in our mind. And I think too often, we as a church in America, we have so much head knowledge. We know what it says. We know what to do. But at some point, there's got to be a step of faith. Our pursuit has to be going after and practicing and doing what Scripture says. That there has to be a commitment in our lives to consume Scripture. And I just want to challenge you today, just in a moment, this is a rhetorical question, right? How much Scripture do you consume in a week? In a day? And I know a lot of times people will be like, I can't read. Like, it's really hard to sit down and read and do devotions, all right? First of all, I think we need to get there, all right? But before that happens, what content are you taking in? What does your social media news feed look like? Right? What is your radio playlists look like? What are the things that we're doing in our free time that are investing in and feeding into us? I think that there's so many times in our life that we have an opportunity to hear and be fed, but yet we're missing it because we're feeding on something else that doesn't give real life. I think that I can't even tell you the number of times that like even a sermon or a series has been sparked by a Bible teacher that I follow on social media, where somebody will say something and it'll just sit there and I'll be like, oh my word, like I've never seen it like that. And it turns into a study and it turns into diving deeper. But part of that is because in those areas, we have to have things that are feeding into us. What does it look like? Again, jumping to Jeremiah 29:11, a lot of us know, right? 29:11, for I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans for you to prosper. We love that. We love that verse. It's great. Do you realize that just two verses later, it talks about how we get there? In verse 13, it says, you will seek me and find me when you seek me with all your heart. We love the I know the plans I have for you, right? We're like, that's awesome. I want to walk into those plans. But the part on the other side of it, the number of times that I've said blessing comes on the other side of obedience, right? And we love the promises that are there. We love, I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, and I believe every one of them. But how we walk into those moments, like side note, Jeremiah is prophesying to an Israelite nation after telling them they're going to be taken over in slaves in Babylon for 70 years. He says, even though you're going to be in that spot, God says to you, I know the plans I have for you. And there's going to be a moment when you seek me, when you turn to me. You're being captured because you're not following. But when you seek me with all your heart, you will find me. I will show up. There's no place that's too far from my hand. But it's on us. It's on us to seek. You know that word seek in Scripture? Can be translated as pursue. When we go after him with all that we have, when we go after his heart, when we pursue him with all that we have, he will show, we will find him, is what it says. He's not hiding. This isn't a game of hide and seek. He's not like trying to stay away from us. He's like, I'm here. But when you seek me with all your heart, that's when you find me. That's when you start to realize who I am. That's when you start to realize the plan that I have for you. Did you know that in the first century, the highest form of worship was actually studying Scripture? I think when we think of worship right now, we think of singing. We think of music that's there, which is definitely a form of worship. I love the singing form of worship. I love music. I love that it's easy for me to remember. It's easy for me to catch on. Like when something's put to a melody, you're like, this is perfect, right? It's really hard sometimes just to memorize Scripture, but when you put a tune behind it, you're like, I think I got all this. This is great. I love that portion of worship. But there's a point where even in that moment in the first century, the highest form of worship was actually study. It was diving into Scriptures. It was seeking and trying to get to the heart of God, because it's his word to us. And it was seeking his heart in the midst of it. And at some point in this time from Old Testament to New Testament, people started studying Scripture not to find the heart of God, but to know more Scripture. And it was this badge of honor on their heart that they would know it, but not put it into practice. They would know everything that it says. They would know the laws. They would know the rules that were there. They could quote it to you, but their lives weren't aligned with it. And in the midst of all of that, like, there's so much knowledge of Scripture. It's one of the things that frustrates me about the people when I'm reading the Gospels, right? When Jesus is literally amongst all of them, the Messiah who's there, and to me is so blatantly obvious, obviously because I know the end of the story as well, right? But you're like, how did they not know this? Like, how did they not see all the incredible signs and wonders? How did they not see the fulfillment of prophecy? If they knew the Old Testament as well as they did, how did they not see it? And then I remember the world that I live in. Because as much as it's easy to see Jesus there, it's also sometimes hard for us to see ourselves on the other side of it. When I know how the story ends, it's easy for me to position myself on the side of Jesus. Yet understanding that we live in a country right now that statistics, the latest one that I found was 2021. So as of 2021, this could have changed in the last couple of years. I don't know. Somewhere around 85% of households in the United States of America have a Bible. As a matter of fact, the average household has about 4.4 Bibles per household. We have access to Scripture. Also, if you're a house that doesn't have a Bible, we give them away for free. We would love for you to have a Bible, because hear me, this is powerful. This is incredible. This is. I would love to have 100% of the households in the United States of America have a Bible. The problem so often isn't access to, it's an understanding of. That we have access to Scripture, But something else that's crazy, in a study of people who do own Bibles and call themselves Christians, less than one-third of those people knew who delivered the Sermon on the Mount. In case you're wondering, it was Jesus. Okay? Matthew chapter 5, 6, and 7 is known as the Sermon on the Mount. A more popular answer to that question, not among the masses, but of people who call themselves Christian and own a Bible and have one in their house, a more popular answer in the United States of America was actually Billy Graham. That Billy Graham delivered the Sermon on the Mount. Hear me, it's not about access. We can talk about it for a really long time. We can even dive in to try and know more about it, but there's a point where we have to allow it to lead and to guide and to change us and to let us walk into acting it out and doing it. We can know all about it. But until we understand the heart of God inside of it and it starts to change us, we start to get a revelation, not just a realization of who it is, but a revelation personally of how much he loves me, how much he loves you, cares for you, has a plan for you. When you seek him, you will find him when you seek him with all your heart. That's what it's about. It's about pursuing his heart. And this is why I think even Jesus was so frustrated with the Pharisees at the time, because they knew it all. It's one thing if he's walking along the countryside, right? And people don't know all the scriptures. They don't have the scrolls. They don't have the Old Testament. They haven't heard the prophecies. It's one thing if that's the case. And then Jesus is teaching them. And so often they're the ones that are like, you've got to be this Messiah guy. But the ones who had the scripture were the ones who were constantly pushing back, the Pharisees and the Sadducees. And it's in that moment, John chapter 5, verses 39 and 40, he says, you study the scriptures diligently. This is Jesus now speaking to them. Because you think in them that there is eternal life, which in case you're wondering, is true. There is eternal life in scripture. But these very scriptures that testify about me. Listen, he's literally saying, yet you refuse to come to me and have life. He's like, you're diving through scripture. You have them. So many times the Pharisees would keep them tied around their neck. They had a wooden box that they would put them in. Or they would like have a headband and keep it on their forehead. Because the Old Testament said, keep them on your mind and in your heart. So they would like physically like keep them over their head. But yet did not allow them to actually change their mind. Right? They physically had them on their head, but would not let it change their mind. They physically had it on their heart, but would not let their heart be transformed by what it said. Jesus is like, you can know everything, but you won't come to me to be able to have the life that you're hoping for. I remember my dad was the first one that said it. He didn't make it up. I've heard it a bunch since then. But there's a saying that says, too many people are going to miss heaven by 12 inches. From their head to their heart. They know who Jesus is, but they won't let him in. They know scripture, but they won't let him change the way that they act. They know what they're supposed to do, but they're not willing to actually be the altar that we talked about before and say, God, take whatever you need that's not supposed to be here. And literally, I'm putting it on an altar as a sacrifice to die. So that the life that I can have is a life that you have for me. Instead, we want to know everything, but still go on living life the way that is comfortable to us. Are we willing to truly pursue? Because we could spend our entire life around Jesus and never be with him. Think of the number of people in Scripture that were around Jesus, but never let him be the Messiah and the life that he was. Again, personal confession. You know what the roughest part of my life, when I look back at it, was? If we're talking like spiritual moments, the driest times in my life It was actually my first 2 years in ministry. I got out of Bible college. I was a youth pastor down in Florida. I was like, this is awesome, right? Every day, I'm diving into scripture. And I could not figure out why I did not feel like I had a relationship with Jesus. And I was like, man, I am working so hard for you. I don't know why this feels so dry. Until there was a revelation late in the game on my part, not because God wasn't telling me, but because I wasn't listening, that I was around Jesus a lot, but I never spent time just with Jesus. And every time he would give me a nugget, I would be like, oh, that's a message, that's a sermon, I gotta give that to someone else, and I never actually consumed it myself. I would read it, my mind would go, I would know that it was for me, and then I would give it away and preach it before I ever let it actually change me. There was a moment where I had to realize that just being around, just being in church all the time and being around him all the time did not make up for relationship. What he wants is to be with us. This word is supposed to be something that we consume. And then when we pour out of our overflow as he continues to fill us up. But the question is, what are we hungry for? Are we hungry to look smart? Are we hungry to have a nugget for someone else to say, oh, here's a Bible verse for you? Or are we hungry because we need to consume, we desire to have him in our lives? Again, great example. I will give my wife credit for this one because she threw me under the bus a couple years ago with this example, which is 100% true, by the way. It's the opening weekend of deer hunting season today. Don't know if you noticed that. Some of you that are here may have a spouse that's in the woods. Some of you aren't here today because you're in the woods. I actually love hunting, okay? Let me back up. I don't really love hunting. I love hanging out with my dad. I love hanging out with my brother. I love hanging out with my kids. I love hanging out with my nephew. Like, the whole idea of deer hunting, like deer camp, that's super fun to me. Like, it's just the time where we come together, we all hang out. But I also know this. There have been multiple times, confession for you, and all of you, I feel more comfortable saying this today because I feel like the real hunters are gone, so you won't judge me on this. There have been multiple times in my life that I have let a deer just walk right past me because I didn't feel like cleaning it. Just like, not today, not feeling it, right? Why? Because I can go to the grocery store, right? Somebody's already done it for me. It's real simple, okay? Part of that is because we live in an incredible place where we have access to food. You want to know a very different side of that coin? Is there are people on this planet that have to hunt, and if they don't get something, their family doesn't eat. And they're determination in that moment is way different than mine. And I think too often we actually, because we've got 85% of the church or households in America have a Bible and 4.4 Bibles per household in the country, we have so much access that we've actually lost our desire and our hunger to truly eat the bread of life. I can get a nugget here or there from social media. I can stop into church on Sunday. If I miss a week here and there, not a big deal. Like, there's enough. But what is our actual heart's pursuit? What if we had a passion and a hunger for his word the way that we're supposed to? That when we wake up in the morning, we're like, man, I need to eat, I need something today because I can't make it from Sunday to Sunday without actually having some type of sustenance in between. There's a moment where every day I need the bread of life. Again, Jesus in Matthew chapter 4, he's being tempted. He's been fasting for 40 days and 40 nights. And then the enemy, the devil, comes and he's like, hey, you could turn this rock into a piece of bread, right? Like, go for it if you're the Son of Man. And Jesus actually quotes Deuteronomy chapter 8. And it's this moment where in Deuteronomy, they're out and going through the wilderness, and God is giving them manna every day, right? And they're starting to get lazy with it. And they were like, we just want some more food. Matter of fact, they're like, we're getting kind of sick of the miraculous food that you give us every morning that we don't have to work for. Could we have some meat? Like, you sent some quail as well? Like, just the entitlement that's even in that. Yet Jesus quotes it in Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 3. He says, he humbled you, causing you to hunger and then feeding you with manna, which neither you nor your ancestors had known, to teach you that man does not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of the Lord. Hear me, we don't live on bread alone. There has to be a hunger and a desire for spiritual food, for sustenance, not just a cute something that we can throw out on social media, but for a depth, for a meal that says, without this, I can't survive. That's where our pursuit is. What is it that we hunger for? John chapter 6, verse 34 and 35, they say to Jesus, they say, sir, always give us this bread. Pause for a moment. You know what happened right before this? Jesus just fed the 5,000. And he pushed out across the lake, and they were like, we got to go follow Jesus, right? Not because he's the Messiah, but that's where free food is, right? Just so you know, it's really easy to gather a crowd with free food. Jesus wasn't worried about gathering a crowd. He was worried about making sure they had an encounter with him as the Messiah. And he was like, here's the deal. Like, this bread you're following me because I gave you bread. And they're like, sir, always give us this bread. Then Jesus declared, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never go hungry. Whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. He's saying, when you eat, there's a point where your body processes that food. And then once it's done processing that food and gets all the nutrients from it, you just go about your day and you start to work off those calories. You start to burn that protein. And at some point, you need to eat again. We get hungry again. And Jesus says, when you come to me, you will realize that I will quench your innermost hunger, your innermost desires, your innermost thirst. I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never go hungry. Whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. What he's saying, even to us today, is we can pursue a lot of things that are temporary. But there's only one thing that will remain. There's only one thing that will quench your deepest hunger. And that's a relationship with Jesus. That's understanding who he is and not just knowing about him, but saying, become Lord of my life. Not just having a head knowledge of who he was so that we can find him on the other side of the lake, but truly intimately saying, Jesus, I know who you are. I know you died on a cross for my sins so that we could have relationship. And then in that moment saying, my life is an altar. If there's something in me that needs to go, if there's an idol inside of me that I hold too highly and I hold it above you, or even just too highly on the priority life, allow your spirit to cleanse me of that. I repent from who I was. I repent from trying to live life on my own and following him. And my question to you today is, what do you hunger for? I just want to ask you to bow your heads and close your eyes as we're about to close here. And I want to ask a question first and foremost to everybody, and that's, what do you hunger for? I know I've asked it a few times, but to allow yourself even to stop and think, what is my biggest desire? What controls my thoughts? What am I obsessing about throughout my day? And where is Jesus on that list? Because some of us today, maybe it's just a recalibration that needs to happen. We just need to go, you know what? I need to desire, I need to pursue more. I need to put you back in your rightful place on the throne on my life. But some of you today, I have a second question, and that's this. Do you need to surrender your life to Jesus? Because we can talk about this a lot. But if you truly believe that Jesus is the Son of God, our only response is submission. If we believe that he is who he said he is, the only response that we have from that moment on is then, Lord, be Lord of my life. It's in that moment in the book of Revelation that says when we believe, or in the book of Romans, I'm sorry, that says when we believe with our heart, and confess with our mouth that he is Lord, that we will be saved. There's no other way to salvation. It's not about knowing enough. It's not about being a good person. It's about saying, God, I know who you are. Be Lord of my life. If that's you today and you've never said yes to Jesus, you've never given him the authority and the reins of your life today, with nobody looking around, I'm looking around just so I can pray for you. Would you do this at this moment, if that's you today, would you just slip up your hand so that I can see it so I can pray with you right now in this place? I see you. I see you. Awesome. I want to lead you in a prayer. Scripture again says that if we believe with our mouth, or believe with our heart and confess with our mouth. With that, I want to lead you in a prayer. There's no secret words. It just says that we confess him with his mouth. So I'm going to lead you in a prayer. But I want everybody to pray with me. Whether you're here in this place, whether you're watching online, I know I can't see you, but Jesus does. And this can be your moment. You don't have to be in a room like this to give your life to Jesus. Would you all repeat after me? Dear Jesus, I know that I have sinned. I know that I have fallen short. But today I believe that you died on a cross to pay the price for my sin. Come into my life today. Cleanse me. Forgive me. I repent and turn from my ways to follow you. From this day forward, be Lord of my life. In Jesus' name we pray today. Amen and amen. To deny